those respective pillars. But we try to exert effort to get as much information as we can. Okay. The NPP has four priority areas mentioned earlier, with four long-term goals, 14 objectives, 24 outcomes, 56 outputs, 93 activities. It's a very, very comprehensive document. If you're going to probably choose just one document that will guide you for the RRM initiatives, the Evergreen Plan is a good document to start with. So objectives reduce vulnerability and exposure to communities to all hazards, enhance capacities of communities, increase the level of awareness, equip the community with skills, ability to cope with negative impacts of disaster, increase the capacity of institutions, so not only individuals, communities, but also institutions, develop and implement comprehensive national and global disaster preparedness policies, decrease the number of preventable deaths and injuries, provide basic subsistence in times of disaster events, restore basic social services also during disaster events. Now for rehabilitation recovery, you have to restore livelihoods or means of livelihoods for communities and individuals, shelters, infrastructure damaged, and then physical and psychological rehabilitation of persons who suffered from disaster events. I'll just go through four slides presenting the four pillars and their objectives, indicators, and then the outcomes. Probably if you're going to streamline our talk, just focus on the outcomes, because those are actually the ones being catered to when you translate the plan or the policy into countable initiatives. Okay, so for prevention mitigation, you have their mainstreaming of the RRM and CCA. You have their environmental management. You have their increased disaster resiliency of infrastructure systems. Community-based and scientific CCA assessment to communities' access to effective and applicable disaster risk financing and end-to-end monitoring. Awareness, increased level of awareness. Communities are equipped with skills, capability, increased DRRM, CCA capacity, developed and implemented comprehensive national local preparedness policies, plans, and systems. Response, well-established disaster response operations. You can see that in the SWP. Adequate and prompt assessment of needs and damages at all levels. Different institutions, different departments in government have their own ways of assessing damages in the field, reporting those and actually mobilizing resources. Integrated and coordinated search, rescue, retrieval. Affected communities are evacuated. Temporary shelter, basic social services, psychological needs, coordinated integrated system for early recovery. And lastly, rehabilitation, economic activities, houses rebuilt, disaster and climate change resilient infrastructure constructed, and then addressing as well the psychological needs of communities and citizens. The next slides, I'll go through them quickly. They'll just point to how the four pillars are actually reflected in certain initiatives within government institutions. Okay, so for DOST, before NOAA was transferred to UP this year, you have there the nationwide operational assessment of hazards, involving hydromet sensors development, upper system, weather, LIDAR, flood net. So, QSD has been busy in terms of mitigation and prevention activities, mostly focusing on SLP, science and technology, research and development. Essentially for flood mitigation systems or early warning system, for us to have that ability to plan, for us to have that ability to respond with an allowable lead time. Yes.
In your view, is it actually a better arrangement that the NOAA is now SUP rather than the OSD? Does it have some more flexibility or mobility, agility that it did not enjoy before when it was under the OSD?
Well, institution-wise, the OSD is a lot bigger. Resource-wise, it has in place so much resources for S&T and R&D. But there are realities in the field, and it was mentioned that NOAA actually funding for that program ceased early this year. And then the man heading it, who is a UP professor, Mahar, actually is with UP. And so now, I think it's just natural that NOAA is adopted by UP as one of their key initiatives for ERR. It's a waste if NOAA would be just left to rot. So you have good people in UP, you have good people in the OSD, but really, in terms of institutional convenience, probably UP is a good enough place for NOAA. Some other initiatives, vulnerability mappings, conflict maps, advisories, volcano, earthquake, tsunami monitoring and warning program. So we have the WATA, the Philippine Scientific Earth Observation Microsatellite, microsatellite. We have Roger, robust and rapidly deployable GSM based stations. So DOSC has been busy. Well, a bit technical, a bit high tech, but if we're talking about mitigation, prevention tools, I guess what they have as a array of possible instruments would help a lot. We can do more. We can probably better our efforts toward mitigation, towards prevention. In some cases, disasters cannot be prevented, but we can better our effort to better respond. And probably that lead time that technology can provide us, as envisioned by the OSD for one, is a good thing and should be there in place for the RR. End-to-end monitoring. I'll just go through some more slides presenting initiatives from different agencies. It's probably not worth discussing deeply each slide, but it's just for you to appreciate that grounding has been taking place in terms of DRRM. So PAGASA, early warning systems, multi-hazard maps, upgrading of their models, and climate field school. That probably is saleable. Vulnerability maps and route index. DOF, disaster risk financing and insurance strategy. It's probably worth noting that GSIS has been doing a lot in terms of insuring government assets, and I think there is one slide here that shows that. But under the OF, it has adopted disaster risk financing and insurance strategy as a comprehensive framework for financial potential solutions. So they have actually commenced DRFI strategies in 10 LGUs and 2 line agencies. OCD, MDMC, DILG, DPM, DWEB, drafting a joint memorandum for the establishment and institutionalization of DRFI solutions, LGUs, and GAs. DENR, the National Union Program, Forestry Law Enforcement, the National Forest Protection Program, among others. Risk transfer instrument, as I mentioned earlier. So GSIS, ensuring property within the bureaucracy. And as reflected there in 2016, ensuring a total of 1 trillion in assets. And the government agency is paying around 3.6 billion in terms of premium. Resilient Infrastructure, DPWH, the National Building Code, Inventory of Infrastructure and Assessment, and then they have their Structural Resiliency Program. DEPEC also has their Disaster Resilient School Building Designs, and the integration of DRM in their curriculum. Housing and land use, mainstreaming CCA, DRR, in the new integrated model zoning ordinance for cities and municipalities. There is a study under one of our published discussion papers. It was released early this year, and it went deeply into discussing DRFI strategies, risk financing strategies, and GSIS was one of those identified organization providing traditional insurance for government offices, and also by law, which was actually crafted around the 1950s. By default, GSIS is our asset insurer for government. Probably not about us recommending. It's really about GSIS operating optimally. Well, right now they are having a monopoly because they're not being taxed as compared to competitors. So they have that advantage. And I guess that would stay as long as they are operating optimally. So this slide is from DILG. It shows their internal way of actually augmenting DRR and policy. So from 2010, then you had RA 10121, 2016, 2015, when they were talking about early preparedness actions to reduce disaster risks, mainstreaming DRR, CCA, local development planning. So a lot has been done, and a lot are still being done by our core agencies being tasked to work within the framework of DRRM. So many internal memorandums, so many internal circulars have been crafted and released, really to ensure that institutional machinations are in place. More on the DILG strategic response in terms of the RRM. So from 2010, when they became vice chair of the preparedness pillar, up to 2016, when they were shifting focus on communities, families, households, and having them, or making them more prepared. So you also have their science-based planning, should make it used, and systemic preparedness for response actions. Another thing worth noting there is the seal of good local governance. The seal of good local governance for disaster preparedness. So you have their profile, you have audits, and you have upgraded indicators. I guess the weakness here is how you standardize everything and how they actually implement it. And I was talking with people from the ILG. It was apparent that the disconnect brought about by the local government code impacts a lot in terms of how leakages from the national and local governments are happening. Although local governments actually look up to a central office in terms of guidance, in terms of the area of possible courses of action. The structural disconnect brought about by the local government code is very apparent. One example would be the difficulty in terms of the central office to dictate, even if you're talking about DRR-related initiatives, they cannot really dictate in terms of actual, concrete courses of action, because local governments are empowered to be, supposedly, self-sufficient in terms of doing their thing. I guess what was retained in my mind when I was talking with the DRRG people was that qualified authority that they have over local governments. And that probably is a reality that we are facing every day. We're going to look at how local governments operate and how they look up to the national government.
Sir, in your analysis, would that disconnect be lessened or exacerbated by something, an idea like federalism?
Well, federalism could be a double-edged sword. That actually magnify what you have now as a setting within local governments. Be not careful. So there are no sweeping ideas probably in terms of how everything would fare or everything would settle down eventually if you adopt that structure. But right now, the local government code has its positives as well as negative drawbacks if you're going to actually talk to individuals or stakeholders in the field. I can't answer you directly in terms of probably the negative or positive implications of such. But you can deduce from what we have now possible magnifications or possible answers to current problems. Could go either way.
Could you explain the disconnect between the, as you have said, between the DIOG and with the local governments in regards to the implementation of the local government?
Okay, well, probably let's go for an example. When I was interviewing people from DILG, one example mentioned to us this potential storm surge in the north. And the central office has very concrete evidence or forecast that it's going to happen. it's going to happen within a few hours. And they were talking to local executives. And the local executives actually chose to ignore such advice. Now, would they be held legally liable if there were casualties or there were damages to properties? Probably yes. But the disconnect is very apparent in that case. Translation.
No, the lack of information and appreciation of the local government units of the types of hazards that they are vulnerable to. I think in many, a lot of issuances, even the newspapers, and a lot of other issuances from other publications has established that. And including, I think, that is why the current MPR there's a current initiative or in the MPR, the 101-21 is being updated, and that particular issue with regards to the definition of certain vulnerable hazard has been addressed.
Yes.
I think it's more on letting people know and making people understand the types of hazards and their capacity to damage certain.
Yes, I actually agree with you totally. Okay,
yes.
As I mentioned earlier, IEC is a very big component of the entry plan of the current policy, and we had that. The failure in translation during the Yolanda event. But in the example that I mentioned, it was your USEC talking to a mayor, to a local executive, and him actually explaining that this is going to happen, and there was no response from the field. So that is an example of disconnect. If you're talking about the citizenry not understanding, for example, the implications of storm surge, as what happened in the Yolanda case, the global case, then it really is a well-reported happening, because it was true that translating S&T information failed, and there was no appreciation in terms of actual potential impacts. Right.
And define the information, the disaster related information that they are available.
Right. And that's why it's not really up to government to disseminate all these very important information. It should be a multi-stakeholder effort, not only on the part of national government agencies, but also for CSOs, for the private sector as well. And I guess we are seeing that right now, the very active involvement of entities outside government. Okay, moving on. The ILG strategic response. That's also, to show you certain details over the years from 2011 to 2016. So from low awareness, very basic, to community and family household preparedness, and getting sectors involved. Okay, this is for the SWD, the National Disaster Response Plan. crafting of the NDRP for earthquake and tsunamis, consequence management for terroristic activities are already in the final stages. This was way back in 2016, so I don't know if they have that now. Still, for the SWD, Istahanan, or the National Household Targeting System for Poverty Reduction, has basis in terms of mobilizing resources for response activities. For example, estimating the number of food banks, estimating the number of relief goods to be given. Establishment of child-friendly, women-friendly spaces, international humanitarian assistance cluster. I guess it's worth noting that starting from Pablo in 2012, we adopted a cluster approach in managing post-disaster activities. So in terms of response, relief, and rehabilitation, that was grounded in Compostela Valley for Pablo, and then for Yolanda in 2013 in Tacloban. Deployment of staff, disaster operations, warehouses, stockpiling, and standby funds, all within the SWD, within the response framework. Mobile HUDs, mechanized packing systems, still augmenting, for example, what the response team is doing, bettering their activities, initiatives. Transitional shelters, livelihood assistance, cash for work. Okay. So in terms of recovery and rehabilitation, you have your action plans, post-disaster risk assessment, pre-disaster risk assessment, rehabilitation recovery plans. As supported by NEDA, you have your reconstruction assistance on Yolanda, CRRP, and the same for Pablo rehabilitation. I'll just show you that we were able to call out certain items in the annual budgets of different institutions, funding for DRR related activities. So for DOSD 2010-2016, have it there. More for DOSD, including foreign assisted projects as indicated in the slide. The ILG from 2010-2016. I think the internal allocation of funds actually show you how serious departments or institutions are in terms of ingraining DRRM in their functions and structures. The SWD, BND. All right. So, probably just a few slides looking at key insights pertaining to institutions or institutional arrangements. In terms of resources, human capital, capacity building, RA1121, particularly the LMP, is substantive. Just go through the document and you'll see there that it's a very, very comprehensive plan with a very, very good array of activities that you can do for the RRM. Resource-wise, we have documented positively increasing levels of resources for the not only for the NDRP fund, but also for other sources. And if you're going to compare, for example, the pre-RA101 level, RA101-21 level, to what we have now, the difference is quite huge. Distribution of resources, an issue. Equity for the poorest LGUs, because 5% of their internal revenue is not the same as the 5% of the internal revenue of First Class Municipality. So the big difference in terms of resources available for local use is there. Financing schemes for preparedness mitigation should be further explored. Tagging arrangement for climate change expenses between Climate Change Commission and Department of Budget Management can be adopted by the NGMC, OCD, and DPM or DRR-related spending. So yung slide kanina, when we showed you how funds are being spent, climate change-related wise, was possible because of this tagging arrangement. It's not being done for DRR related expenses, so I guess it's but natural for us to go for that. LGUs had difficulty complying with the human resource provisions under RA 1121, leading to a dearth of DRR and workers stationed at the municipal level. Supposedly, by law, they can create 4 positions, 1 officer, 3 staff for provinces, cities, municipalities. There are those localities that are able to comply, those with funds for those positions. But many others are unable to shell out resources for those plantilla positions, creating the problem, the difficulty. DRRM-related assets address different organizational mandates and priorities, as questioned earlier by Dr. Grounding science and promoting M&E. Data and scientific know-how have to be processed and translated, as pointed out earlier by our friend there. Know-how should be translated into appropriate behaviors on the ground. And this could be promoted through dissemination of appropriate information through multi-stakeholders. Multi-stakeholder channels. Institutional niches. Some organizations are in better strategic and resource position to assume certain responsibilities. Okay, for example, the issue between the DILG and OCD on the review and recommendation of appropriate plans for LGUs. Implementation of any monitoring and evaluation mechanism to consider the checklist of DRRM plan activities and outputs. As repeatedly mentioned, the entry plan is very comprehensive. And if you're going to base your DRRM activities on those array of courses of action listed there, you'll never go wrong. Strict reporting of DRRM resources, including the status of calamity funds, response funds, institutional funding. This is actually mentioned in the GAA document. So, institutions are required to actually report the status of funds. But there was a veto message there from the president qualifying this. So not all institutions are required. Institutional leadership initiative is key. You can see there, for example, in the listing that there are plenty of institution-based initiatives related to DRRM. This may not be premised under the array of listings indicated in the entry plan, or they may not be mentioned specifically under RA 10121, but they are there, and all because of the leadership in institutions, organizations. Institution-led initiatives under the 4 thematic pillars were identified and implemented with relative independence from the MPP. Now, this is probably among the items listed here, this is probably one of the most controversial. Because what you have in the slides presented earlier are DRRM activities that could easily fit the umbrella plan of RA 10121. But talking with individuals in those different core organizations dealing with DRRM, a lot of them were saying that they were doing such activities, having such programs, because of their own initiatives, because of their own institutional mandates, because of their own institutional trusts. So even without probably guidance from the DRRM executives, they have this. And that probably could be better in terms of direction, in terms of crafting, and probably in terms of resource orientation. NTMC Secretariat is mandated with coordinative roles in the identification, implementation, monitoring of DRRM programs, projects, and activities. We're going to look at it like this. OCD is a very powerful organization because it is mandated by law to actually coordinate the implementation of the entry plan, and the entry plan is very substantive. NTMP has not received the same treatment as the PDD. Probably not so many individuals or even executives or even decision makers have read the plan, but it is very comprehensive, but it's not receiving enough probably leverage in terms of resource allocation, unlike what we have with PDD. Issues on institutional authority, facilitative arrangements, and applicable platforms need to be addressed and clarified. Probably self-explanatory. Institutional platform need to harmonize the institutional divide between climate change and DRRM. It's probably a given, probably all of you know this firsthand, because there is that divide. Avenues for productive discourses, institutional collaboration, and capacity augmentation need to be instituted for exchanges. And really, it's about sharing. It's about disseminating usable information, usable know-how, and augmenting capacities, not only of individuals, but communities as well as organizations. NTMC, given its structure and composition, perennially suffers from competition with other departmental missions. An alternative bureaucratic platform responsible for all phases of the RRM that we export. Institutionalized? Probably the answer here is very qualified, because if you're going to look at institutionalization as defined by probably the internalization of fundamental values or objectives in organizations, in their culture, in their functions, you'll see those, you'll see that in individual line agencies or national government agencies. So it's there. The RRM is actually quite ingrained now in our conscious mind. And probably there are reminders every day as to what would happen if we are not prepared. We don't mitigate, we don't manage risks. But these are individual organizations doing their thing. No matter how good those things are, these are still leader-led organizations. Now, the full realization of RA1121 and the NTMP ultimately requires appropriate sectoral and institutional translation of the national agenda, reflecting more refined institutional arrangements, policy support, feedback, and evaluation mechanisms. So really, it's about the NTP being cascaded into sectoral plans, into local government plans, local government development plans. The law by itself is a good umbrella for DRRM initiatives. It probably would cover almost all activities that anyone could think of. And that is probably what happened in many cases when individual agencies, individual institutions in government were having their own programs, projects related to DRRM. But a more refined way of actually going through things is to have that guide, to have that law, to have that plan be translated into institutional initiatives. In the end, it's probably what's happening now, because it's like playing with cards. You have there your board, your bullseye, and probably even a small child that throws a dart could hit something there. And that dart, that board probably represents the entry plan in RA1121, a very comprehensive umbrella. But really, to better our initiatives, to better what we're doing, is to have a more guided way in navigating the scheme of things. So the answer there, in terms of institutionalization, is very qualified. I guess that's it.